For inhalation agents, now we know which are the commonly ones we are using. Nitrous, ISO, SIVO, DES. Hai na? So we have to understand how these inhalation agents, they start from the machine end, right? And then they finally land up reaching our tissues. So how do they land up reaching our tissues? That we'll understand today. So what is the main objective of giving the inhalation agent? That we want a constant and optimal partial pressure in the brain. So when I say that our inhalation agent has to reach the tissue, the main tissue that we want to work on is the brain, right? Which controls the consciousness, correct? So we want to deepen the brain. That means our main target tissue is the brain. So that's why I'm writing over a partial pressure of the brain is what we want to maintain constant and optimal. Partial pressure of what? So if I'm giving isoflurane, I want to maintain a constant and optimal partial pressure of isoflurane in the brain throughout the surgery. That is my aim. Okay. So for that, what do we need to achieve in the patient's body? We need to achieve something which is known as a steady state equilibrium. Okay. So steady state means which means what? There's no fluctuation. There's a constant level of equilibrium. So what is the meaning of this equilibrium? Okay. So equilibrium means what? That now I'm talking about, suppose, isoflurane. Okay. So I want that the partial pressure of isoflurane in the alveolus at one point will reach equilibrium with the partial pressure of isoflurane in the brain. Okay. How will that happen? So partial pressure in the alveolus will be equal to the partial pressure in the blood, will be equal to the partial pressure in the brain. Okay. So there is a state of equilibrium at all the levels. Okay. That is when I will say that, yes, I have achieved constant and optimal partial pressure in the brain and my patient is under deep general anesthesia. Okay. So how will this inhalation agent move and finally reach the brain? Okay. So just like we had learned oxygen cascade, so the inhalation agents also which we are using, they are volatile. So some of them are available as liquid form, right? Like isoflurane, sevoflurane, they're available in the liquid form. Ultimately, all our inhalation agents, even desflurane, they're all converted into vapors, right? In the gaseous forms. These vapors are then added on to our gas combination, which is oxygen and nitrous, correct? Or oxygen and air, and that is how we deliver to the patient. So this inhalation agent also will, because it's in a gaseous state, it's also going to follow the rule of partial pressures, right? The one that we had learned in the cascade. So it will move from an area of higher partial pressure towards an area of lower partial pressure, right? So where is the highest partial pressure now? The point from where the input is occurring of the inhalation agent. Input is occurring from where? From the machine end, right? So when I start the surgery, I have just now put the endotracheal tube and I have now switched on the inhalation agent. So right now, inhalation agent is maximum where? Maximum at the machine end, right? Where the fresh gas flow is coming and then finally to the patient. So maximum is there, correct? Alveolus, does in the initial first breath, is there any agent in the alveolus? No, because we have just started the case. So there is lesser over here and almost nil, correct? So what will happen as you give subsequent breaths, some amount of agent will move along this and finally reach the tissue, right? So there is a partial pressure gradient along which this inhalation agent is moving. Isoflurane is moving, correct? Now we know law of that partial gradient means what? So any gas will move from a place of higher concentration to a place of lower concentration, from a place of high partial pressure to a place of low partial pressure. So same rule is applicable here. Over here at the beginning of the surgery, partial pressure over here is higher. The inspired partial pressure is higher. And the partial pressure at the level of the tissues is very low. So it will follow this gradient. Okay. Now what will happen if this gradient is very wide? For example, when we started the case, machine had, suppose I started with 1% isoflurane and 49% oxygen, 50% nitrous settings I have put on the machine. So here, how much isoflurane is there? 1%, right? But here there is nothing. Here there is nothing. So this gradient is very wide, correct? There is a very wide gradient because we have just started the case. So when the gradient is very wide, there will be faster movement of isoflurane forwards, correct? Faster movement forwards. After maybe 5 minutes, 10 minutes of the case, once the case has started, multiple number of breaths have gone to the patient. Now, isoflurane has managed to reach the tissue level. It has managed to develop certain amount of partial pressure at the tissue, certain amount of partial pressure within the blood, certain in the alveolus, right? So everywhere isoflurane has gone and occupied. Correct. So now what is happening about that gradient? The difference in the partial pressure between all of these components has become less. Means gradient has become less. So when gradient becomes less means what? The flow will become a little slow. The movement along this will become a little slow. Okay. So that is what we have to understand. Partial pressures, the gradient, and how, whether it is going to move faster or it's going to move slow. Okay. Now, so what we need to know, which are the levels? So first we have to understand 1, 2, and 3. Okay. So there are this first, second, and third place at which the transfer is occurring of the inhalation agent. So the first is what? From machine to alveolus, that is step one. From alveolus to blood movement, step two. From blood to tissue, this is the third step. Okay. So every step, there is some factor which is going to determine the movement of this isoflurane or sevoflurane, right? So what are all nitrous also, right? So what is going to determine these factors? So just quickly we will see and then we'll understand each factor. Okay. So from machine to the alveolus, that is the first step. Okay. So what are the factors which are going to affect? So the inspired partial pressure means what? The partial pressure of the agent that is inspired. So the fraction of the agent, which I mean to say is that if I'm giving a patient 50-50 oxygen and nitrous, I have not switched on isoflurane, suppose for example. So the inspired concentration, basically inspired partial pressure, I mean to say inspired concentration, inspired fraction, you can consider this as interchangeable terms. Okay. So if I'm starting with, so what is the factor that is determining here? If I'm starting with 10% nitrous or 30% or 50% or 60%, this percentage will matter. Okay. The next, what I'm saying is alveolar ventilation, which means what? I'm talking about minute ventilation, respiratory and tidal volume. So that will affect the movement, okay, of the agent from machine to alveolus. Next, the properties of your anesthetic breathing system, which means what? The properties of your circuit. And then FRC. So now we'll understand each of this individually. Okay, so in the first, which is there, the inspired partial pressure. So in that, we need to understand there are two important concepts that we need to understand. Okay, one is concentration effect and there is second gas effect. Concentration effect means from the name, you can understand that something is getting concentrated. There is something which is getting concentrated. That's why this name concentration effect has come. So now what is this term telling you? It tells you that there is a relation between the inspired percentage and the percentage that you achieve in the alveolus. I'll tell you again. So percentage, the same thing. It tells you that there is a relation between the fraction of the inhalation agent inspired and the fraction of the inhalation agent achieved in the alveolus are interrelated, which means what? If I keep a higher fraction of inspired agent, I will achieve a higher fraction of that agent in the alveolus, all right? And that will happen at a very fast speed. So if I start with a higher inspired fraction, I will achieve a high fraction within the alveolus in a shorter time. So we'll understand that with the help of an example. So concentration effect, now this property is seen only in nitrous. If you must have read that concentration effect and second gas effect, although they are properties of inhalation agents, but they are properties of those inhalation agents which are given in higher concentration, which are given in a higher fraction. So which is that? It is only nitrous, right? We give nitrous up to 50%, 70% sometimes, right? 30%. So it contributes a large chunk of that 100% of gas which the patient is receiving, right? Whereas sevoflurane and all, where it is somewhere around 1%, 2%, desflurane 6%. So you're giving a lesser quantity, right? So this is applicable to those volatile agents which are given in large quantities, which is nitrous. So keep in mind, this is applicable for nitrous. So now what I'm trying to say that higher the inspired fraction of nitrous, you start off with a higher fraction, you will achieve a higher fraction in the alveolus in a shorter period of time. Hence, you can have more faster the concentration in the alveolus can be achieved. So we'll just understand with an example. So suppose Now I am just drawing, suppose just consider this alveolus as a lung tissue, okay? So we can understand it easily, okay? I am giving this patient 50:50. So I have started the case 50:50, O2:nitrous, I am giving to the patient, okay? How much, now we'll consider the total lung capacity of the lung is 4 liters, okay? So if total lung capacity is 4 liters and we have filled up the lungs with 50:50 oxygen and nitrous, right? So I have filled up the lung, 50% oxygen, and I filled it up with 50% nitrous, correct? This means what? Suppose my lung capacity is 4 liters, which means what? I have filled up the lung with 2 liter oxygen and 2 liter nitrous. This is what I have filled up the lungs with. Now you understand and see how concentration occurs within the lung. I have started with a high, remember, I started with a high fraction of nitrous, 50%, the high fraction. Now, nitrous has a property to diffuse very fast, okay? Because it has got a low blood gas solubility. What is blood gas solubility? We'll understand ahead in some time. But just remember that nitrous has a property to diffuse across into the blood at a very fast speed. So very fast nitrous is going to move, okay? Now, half of this nitrous has managed to move into the blood. Half of this has moved. What am I left with now after half of it has gone? So now this 2 liters was there, right? 1 liter has already entered into the blood. 1 liter nitrous, 50% managed to enter into the lung because of its fast diffusing property. Now I am left with how much proportion of nitrous? Only 25% nitrous I'm left with here. Correct? Which means what? 1 liter I have gone, it's gone into the blood. I am left with 1 liter here. And this is a void. Correct? There is a void which is left. Among this full, the whole lung capacity, 4 liters I had filled with 50-50 oxygen nitrous. 2 liters oxygen, 2 liters nitrous was in the lung. Okay. Out of which half of that nitrous has quickly moved out into the blood. Half of the nitrous means what? Out of 2 liters nitrous, 1 liter nitrous has gone into the blood. Now, I am left with only 1 liter nitrous cumulatively in the lungs. All right. And there is some void. Obviously, there is a void because that space which was occupied by that nitrous is now a void because that nitrous has moved into the blood. Now, how much is the amount of gas that is remaining in my lungs? So the amount of gas that I've got remaining is what? 3 liters in total. I have got right now 3 liters remaining total. I've got 2 liters of oxygen and 1 liter nitrous which is remaining here. Okay. And now what has happened? Now understand this, the first part, the step one of the concentration effect. Okay. The first step. So now I am left with the total from 4 liters capacity. My lung has come to 3 liters. Only 3 liters gas is present in my lung. Out of this 3 liters gas, how much nitrous is there? I have 1 liter nitrous. And I have got, it is there in 3 liters of total. Right? Total gas. Nitrous is contributing how much? 1 liter to this overall 3 liter which is left inside. 1/3, which means what? 33%. Is nitrous concentration in the lung, correct? I was left with how much? 25, wasn't I? I was left with 25, but it, actually what it has come to, it is 33, it is not 25% now, because my overall lung volume only, the overall gas amount in my lung has become less. So this is a step one. So you see this percentage has increased. So this is the step one of the concentrating effect. Okay. Now, step two of concentrating effect. Now, what has happened? There is a void. You will tell me, how can we have a void in the lung? Obviously, we can't, right? So a next breath comes in. Patient will either inspire, correct, if he's spontaneously breathing, or else machine will deliver if he's on controlled ventilation. The next breath has come. Now, understand what is the composition of this next breath. Okay. So now we know that there is a void. All right. The next breath will come and it will fill up this void. Okay. What is the proportion of the next breath, the gas in the next breath? 50 is to 50, because that is my machine setting. How much void is left over here? 1 liter, right? Because so total capacity was 4 liters, of which 3 is already filled inside the lung. 1 liter is missing. So that 1 liter is the amount of the next breath. This 1 liter is containing how much oxygen, nitrous? 50-50%, half-half. Means I have 500 ml nitrous and 500 ml oxygen that is going to fill up this void over here, right? So now let's understand how this void is now going to look like in the next breath. So I'll just draw this a little bigger, correct? Here I was left with 2 liters and here I'm left with 1 liter nitrous, right? This 1 liter void which was left is going to be filled up with 500 ml nitrous and 500 ml oxygen, correct? Now I have reached 4 liters again in the second breath. Now at the end of the second breath, how much nitrous do I have in the alveolus? Basically, how much nitrous do I have in the lung? Let's calculate. I have got nitrous 1 liter here. I have got nitrous over here. So I have got 1 liter plus half. So 1.5 liter. What is the whole volume inside of gas? 4 liter, right? I have got 2 liters oxygen here, correct? And I've got 1 liter nitrous, 2 plus 1, 3. 3 plus 500, 350. 350 plus 500, 4 liters. So I am at total 4 liters. How much is the percentage of nitrous now after this first breath? 37.5%. Right. So I had 33%. Now I'm at 37.5%. Now again, 50% of this nitrous will diffuse out. The next breath, I will be above 37.5%. Then I will go up, up, up. Every breath that comes, the nitrous concentration in the lung will keep going up step by step. So far, is this understood? Right? We had how much? 50 is to 50 oxygen and nitrous. Remember this, huh? I will just erase this. Now, suppose, what concentration effect told us? What was the term that statement that concentration effect made? Higher the concentration of the inspired agent, that means fraction of the inspired agent, faster will the fraction in the alveoli be achieved, right? Higher was the fraction here, starting 50%. Faster, within second breath, we had reached 37.5%. Within the next few breaths, we would cross 40% also. And ultimately, we would reach 50%. We would reach 50% means what? We would reach a state of equilibrium. What we want to ultimately achieve after a certain minutes of starting the case, right? After 10, 15 minutes or so, we want to achieve equilibrium, don't we? So that will be achieved faster if I start with a faster proportion of nitrous. What if I start with less proportion of nitrous? All right. So you will understand the actual difference that it makes. Now, suppose I have started the case. And I say, I don't want to use so much nitrous. I'm going to use 90% oxygen, 10% nitrous. My ratio is 90 is to 10. Now what will happen in my whole lung is there. This is my whole lung. And there's 4 liters capacity in my lung, which is going to be replaced with 90 is to 10 ratio, O2 is to nitrous. So what am I going to have here? So this is the lung. I have got 90%, my first breath, which I have given 90% oxygen and 10% nitrous, I have given to the patient. Nitrous has a very fast diffusing property, right? So if this is the blood over here, nitrous 50%, half of the nitrous will move out super fast, okay? So half of this nitrous is gone, okay? That means what I'm left with, let's just do with the percentages because the numbers become really too numerical, okay? So now I'm left with 5% nitrous here and this remaining 5% area has become a void. This has become a void. Now void will be filled up with what? The same thing, the same ratio. So 90 is to 10 ratio of O2 is to nitrous will fill up this void, right? This void means now I'm going to fill it up. So let's see how I fill it, all right? So there was a 5% space void left, of which 90:10. So a 5%, so this will fill up this 5%. So that gives what? 4.5% oxygen and 0.5% nitrous will fill up this space. Are you with me? A 5% void is over here. 90% of that 5% void is how much? 90% of it is 4.5 and 0.5 nitrous, because I have done 90:10. How much is the oxygen I'm left with over here? 90 plus 4.5. How much oxygen do I have? 94.5%. And how much nitrous do I have? 5.5% of nitrous. How much nitrous? 5.5%. Our point over here, we are all, our focus is on nitrous, because nitrous is showing concentration effect, right? I started with the case with 10% with nitrous at only a ratio of 90:10. And I have managed to achieve how much in the alveolus in the end of the first breath? I have managed to achieve only 5.5%. Have I achieved any kind of equilibrium? No. The case will go on and on and on and on. It will take me a lot of time to achieve this same 10% in the alveolus and get an equilibrium. So, whereas when I use 50:50 ratio, when I use 50:50 ratio, at the end of that first breath, how much nitrous was I having in the alveolus? I landed up with 37.5% of nitrous in the alveolus, didn't I? So this is concentration effect. Okay. You start with a higher fraction of inspired concentration of that inhalation agent. You will achieve the concentration in the alveoli faster, within less time, that, and subsequently you will achieve equilibrium between inspired and alveoli also within lesser time. So what is the difference now? You see the difference between this is how much? It's almost 6.8 times. Almost 6.87 times. So much difference is there. So you understand, if I use less proportion of nitrous, I'm going to take so much time, lots and lots of time to achieve the concentration in the alveoli. And if I take more time to achieve concentration in the alveoli, I will take more time to achieve equilibrium with the brain. Ultimately, that is where I want to develop equilibrium, right? This is concentration effect. Second gas effect. From the name only, we understand that there is some second gas which is going and there is some effect happening on it. Simple. Let's keep it very simple. Second gas effect, just like concentration effect, is a property which is seen with nitrous agent. Okay, it's seen with the help of nitrous. What does second gas tell you? That just like how nitrous is able to increase its concentration in the alveolus, it also helps to increase the concentration of isoflurane or SIBO or DES in the alveolus. Okay, so we'll understand how the ISO or SIBO or DES or halothane or whichever volatile agent you're using, how their concentration in the alveolus is increasing just because of adding nitrous along with it, how nitrous is helping us, right? So this is a property which is of nitrous and we'll see how. Okay, so now suppose I start the case with 1% isoflurane. Okay, I have taken 49% oxygen and I have taken 50% of nitrous. This is my settings on my anesthesia machine. Okay. So now we know the total lung capacity, which we have, the whole lung is 4 liter. This is all for simple understanding. Okay. I don't mean to say that I'm going to ventilate the patient with such. It's just for a simple understanding. Okay. So the lung capacity is this much. Which means what? Now the first breath that I give to the patient, ultimately I'm going to replace this 4 liters, right? So this 4 liters is there, which means what? This is going to be 40 ml ISO plus how much? 1960 ml oxygen and 2000 ml nitrous. I have done nothing very fancy. Just how much percentages they are there means how much volumes of this individual agents is going to be there. In this, 40% ISO, this. So what's, now let's understand. This is the lung. The lung is having 1% isoflurane which is what, 40 ml? The lung is having 49% oxygen, which is 1960 ml. And the remaining 50% is nitrous, which is 2 liter. Simple, just like the before diagram. Just that I have added isoflurane now for understanding what is second gas effect. Nitrous, we know nitrous. What property it is having? Fast. This is the blood which is flowing through the lung, and nitrous is like just waiting. When I come in contact with the blood, and I'll quickly move out. Half of this nitrous has gone out. Half of the nitrous has gone out. So 2 liters, 1 liter is left behind. And 1 liter nitrous has entered into the blood. Patafat. I am left with now a void. I am left with a void. 1 liter void in my lung. Next breath came. Okay. Now next breath is coming. It's going to be replacing this 1 liter void. Will be replaced in the next breath. Okay. Next breath is what again? 1% iso, 49% oxygen, 50% nitrous. My composition of next breath, volume of next breath is 1 liter, right? So that comes to how much? I have 10 ml iso. Then I have, what is the calculation? 10 ml, 490 ml oxygen and 500 ml nitrous. Just understand, this is not very difficult. It's not like very high fancy maths or anything. What I've done, 1 liter is the total composition of the next breath, right? 1 liter is containing what? Half liter of nitrous, because 50%, half of this, 500 ml nitrous. 49% of 1 liter, 490 ml oxygen. 10% of 1 liter, 10 ml isoflurane. This is going to fill up the void over here in the next breath. Okay. Now, after that second breath came, this was the first breath, what happened? Now, second breath came, right? Second breath, and now this has filled up the void. Now, how much isoflurane I have here? 40 ml here, correct? Void, in the void, I'm having 10 ml, which has been depressed. So now, how much isoflurane do I have? How much iso do I have? 50 ml. Don't I? I have total 50 ml isoflurane. Out of this 4 liters, how much it is? What is the percentage? Out of this 4 liters total lung capacity, this full, what is the proportion of isoflurane? We should know that, right? So when you divide this, you will come with the answer 1.25%. You divide it and you see peacefully. Didn't I start with 1% isoflurane?
Yes.
I have landed up with 1.25 in the lung, just in the second breath. This is concentration effect. This is concentration effect, which is seen in isoflurane thanks to nitrous, hence known as second gas effect. So all thanks to nitrous for moving so fast to the blood that it creates a void, allows more of the agent to enter in, ultimately causing a increasing the concentration of the agent in the alveolus. So as the number, this is only the second breath, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, as the breath progresses, the inhalation agent concentration will increase here. And at one point, we shall achieve equilibrium. So is this understood how nitrous, because of its concentrate second gas effect property, because of mainly its high diffusing property, it is able to increase the concentration of our volatile agent here. So be it isoflurane, sevoflurane, desflurane, whatever, it helps to increase its concentration here. That's why this is known as the second gas effect of nitrous. We'll see the next, which is alveolar ventilation and how alveolar ventilation is affecting the movement of our agents, right, to the alveoli. So we know that if you increase the alveolar ventilation, what is alveolar ventilation? Minute ventilation, basically it's that, right, minus the dead space. So if you increase alveolar ventilation, means what? You're increasing the delivery. You're increasing delivery of nitrous, you're increasing delivery of isoflurane. So there'll be induction will be faster, right? You must have seen, you started the case and you just hyperventilate for a very brief period and you will achieve your depth of anesthesia really fast. That means the induction has happened. You're hastening the induction. If you give a very slow rate of ventilation, the time taken for you to deepen the plane will be more. Simple as that. Okay. Now, what we need to understand is when a patient is spontaneously breathing, how the inhalation agent is affecting its own uptake. Sevoflurane is affecting its own uptake. Isoflurane is affecting its own uptake from the machine. How is that happening? We have to understand that. Okay, so when this patient is spontaneously breathing, so every breath, there is some amount of agent which is entering into the patient, right? At one point, there will be equilibrium. At one point, what will happen? The partial pressure in the alveolus will be equal to the blood, will be equal to the brain, which means what? The depth of anesthesia has been achieved. All right. So at one point, the pressure, partial pressure of isoflurane or sevoflurane in the alveolus will be equal to the partial pressure in the blood of sevoflurane, will be equal to partial pressure of sevoflurane, which we have achieved in the brain. And the patient has gone into a deep plane of anesthesia. Okay. He went into a deep plane. He went into a deep plane because now the nerve conduction in the brain has depressed. Now what will happen? Respiratory center is located where? Brain. In the brain. Because of the deeper plane, the brain activity is suppressed. And now respiratory center is depressed. What happens if the respiratory center is depressed? Patient's minute ventilation will come down. That means what? The respiratory signals which are going have now reduced from the brain. Minute ventilation has come down. Minute ventilation has come down, which means what? The amount of agent entering the patient has now reduced because ventilation has reduced. Patient has himself reduced his ventilation. We have done nothing. He's spontaneous. Okay. Uptake of the agent has decreased, right? Uptake of inhalation agent has decreased. Uptake has decreased. Now, what will happen? What is the situation in his body? The situation in his body is that the alveolar partial pressure was equal to the blood, was equal to the brain partial pressure. Did I say it was equal to the kidney partial pressure, or did I say it was equal to the muscle partial pressure? Did I? No. No. Okay. We'll understand that later why. So the partial pressure is achieved very fast in the brain. The brain takes very less time, okay, for the partial pressure to achieve. So right now what happened? The brain partial pressure was achieved. Patient went in a deep plane of anesthesia. His respiratory center got depressed. His breathing became slowed down, okay? His intake became less. What is the situation in the body now? The situation in the body is that the amount of sevoflurane present in his brain is much more than the amount of sevoflurane that is present in other parts of his body. Okay. So the amount of sevoflurane in other tissues of his body, which I mean is what? His muscles, his fat, okay? Everywhere the sevoflurane concentration is much less than the brain. Now what will happen? There is a difference in the pressures. There's a difference in the concentration. So now, from the brain, because now brain has got more sevoflurane, the sevoflurane will move out from the brain. It will start moving out. Because now intake of sevoflurane has become less. The amount of sevoflurane in his blood is less. So blood sevoflurane is less. Brain sevoflurane is more. So obviously sevoflurane go from where? From brain, it will go to the blood. From blood, it will go to the tissues. Ultimately, what happened? The amount of sevoflurane in his brain became so less that he came to a lighter plane. The patient came into a lighter plane. By coming in a lighter plane, now what has happened? Again, his respiratory center got activated. And again, his breathing increased. Now his breathing has increased. More sevoflurane is entering in his body because his breathing has increased. Right? So this cycle, this is a negative feedback cycle, which is a property which is seen only in spontaneous breathing patient, because the the inhalation agents are controlling the respiratory center and the brain over here, aren't they? Right? This will not be seen in a patient who I'm doing controlled ventilation, because breathing is in my hand, not in the patient's respiratory center. So now we are still at that point where we are from machine to alveolus. We are still understanding that part. In that, the third point, which was what? The property of anesthesia breathing circuit. Okay. That also will affect. Okay. So if you have a breathing circuit which is very long, remember, I'm not talking about dead space here. I'm talking about a circuit which is very long. Okay. A large volume circuit, very long circuit. Okay. So when you start a case, you have started a case and you've attached a circuit, won't it take some time for the partial pressures which are coming from the machine end, right? The inspiratory, the fresh gas flow end. And then you have the circuit. That circuit is containing what? Room air. Isn't it? When you started the case, it's containing room air. So won't it take time for this agent coming from here, develop that concentration and replace the room air from the circuit, ultimately reach the alveoli, right? So longer circuit, large volume circuit, it will take more and more time for you to achieve the concentration and partial pressure in your alveolus. Okay. So that is a property of the circuit which is going to affect. So a longer circuit, large volume circuit will prolong. So what some people do, they prime the circuit. If you hear any senior consultants, many of them say, have you primed the circuit? What is priming the circuit? So priming the circuit is basically removing the room air from the circuit, filling it up with this 1% ISO, 49% oxygen, or whatever proportions you have put on your machine settings, you want to fill up your circuit with that. That is priming of circuit. So you induce, so the case, patient gets induced under GA faster, right? Because then you will achieve the alveolar partial pressure also faster. You will save time and the patient won't come to a lighter pain. Patient will go deep. It will take lesser time. So this is understood, right? Then the other thing is the fresh gas flow. How much are you keeping it? Are you keeping, if you start off a case with a very low fresh gas flow of like 0.5 liters total flow, huh, you are like, I want to do this metabolic ventilation, or I want to do minimal flow. So if you keep such flows in the beginning of the case, how are you going to be able to achieve alveolar partial pressure in short amount of time? No. So you must have seen, when you want to build up the alveolar partial pressure, when you want to deepen the plane of the patient faster, if you will keep the fresh gas flow at a higher rate, okay, in the closed circuit, like if you keep it at 3 liters, 4 liters, if you keep it a higher fresh gas flow, you will achieve the partial pressure faster. Your time taken for induction of this patient will be lesser. He will achieve depth of anesthesia faster. So fresh gas flow is also affecting it. Volume of the circuit is affecting it. And the property of the circuit that you're using. So sometimes you have plastic circuit, rubber circuit. These volatile agents that we're using, they have a property go and dissolve in things. Okay. They have a property. They have a lipophilic property. And they have the capacity to go and dissolve on substances they come in contact with. So when it comes in contact with the circuit, it has a... And if the circuit property is such, it will go and dissolve on the surface of the circuit. Inside the tubing, it will go and dissolve. So I might have set away 1.1%. I might have set some amount of isoflurane, but less is going to the patient because a lot of it is getting dissolved on the surface of the anesthesia breathing circuit. So is this understood? So if the circuit has a property of absorbing a lot of agent, lesser agent will reach the patient. Therefore, it will take you longer time to achieve the partial pressures and equilibrium and depth of anesthesia. The ratio of the alveolar ventilation to the FRC is directly proportional to the partial pressure that you will achieve in the alveolus. Okay, alveolar ventilation means what? Minute ventilation minus the dead space. Okay, so that ventilation upon the FRC. So if this ratio is more, if the ratio is more, means partial pressure in the alveolus will be more, direct proportion. Okay. Now, why is this important? Because this ratio is high in bachus. Okay. It's high in neonates. So what is this ratio in neonates? The ratio in neonates is 5:1, which is quite a high ratio. Whereas the ratio in adult, it is 1.5:1. The ratio in adults is lesser than neonates. Okay. So if this means what? Direct proportional to this, right? So if the ratio is high, means there will be fast induction. And here there will be slow induction.